Hey guys, Justin here. So Scorpion Capital, a short seller known for releasing detailed short seller reports, just released a 188-page report on QuantumScape stock. And the report is pretty eye-opening, even for someone like myself that has already done many hours worth of research and made multiple videos on QuantumScape stock in the past. Now, just in case you are wondering, I did actually read all 188 pages of the report before making this video, which took me quite a while to do. So if you appreciate me doing that, feel free to hit the like button. But the reason I read all 188 pages is because I wanted to make sure I was fair and that I picked up on all of the details in the report, both big and small. Now, before I get into the details of the report, the one thing I need to mention is that the report does rely heavily on testimonies from experts and former employees, which is not a bad thing and is completely valid for a short seller like Scorpion to do. However, I personally don't want to rely too much on these firsthand accounts simply because they don't represent concrete evidence, but rather unsubstantiated claims. So they might be accurate or they might not be. And it could be for many different reasons, such as an employee who is disgruntled or was fired, and now they have an axe to grind with the company. Or it could be that they left a long time ago and breakthroughs have happened since they left. So there are a lot of different scenarios where a former employee could be knowingly or even unknowingly giving false information, and we wouldn't know. So that's why I am not going to focus on the claims made by ex-employees of QuantumScape in this video. But with that being said, let's go ahead and get into the details of the report. The report is not organized great in my opinion, and it does jump around quite a bit from idea to idea. But from reading the entire report, I was able to break down the arguments in the report into three main categories. The first looks at the involvement of key investors such as Volkswagen, the second deals with the technology itself, and the third is discrepancies in the data they presented at their December 8th Battery Day presentation. So let's start first with the report's criticisms of QuantumScape's technology, and then we will cover the other two categories afterwards. The biggest problem with the technology that the report highlights is the problem of dendrite formation. Now, this is not surprising because in my past research on QuantumScape, this topic has received widespread criticism from experts, and it is one of the biggest challenges of making a commercially viable battery, which the Scorpion report makes sure to highlight. In fact, Scorpion believes the dendrite problem is so severe that they mention the word dendrite in the report over 200 times. So I'm not going to try to cover all of the arguments they make against why it's unlikely that QuantumScape has solved this problem, but I will cover what I feel like are some key slides. If we look at slide 52, we can see why dendrites are such a big problem. Dendrites are metallic growths that occur inside the battery and have the potential to quickly grow until they ultimately cause the battery to short and therefore become useless, which is kind of a big problem. In fact, it is such a big problem that Scorpion notes it has prevented progress in the solid-state battery field for over 50 years. But on slide 69, we can see a quote from QuantumScape's CEO where he said that they have finally solved the dendrite problem once and for all. And I did some more digging and found this article from December 19th of 2020, where the CEO takes it even a step further and says not only have they been able to finally solve the dendrite problem, but that they also have figured out a way to make this new magic material manufacturable and also scalable, which is honestly incredible. In 10 short years, a company that has operated in stealth mode, a phrase that we have heard of before in regards to another highly respectable EV company, I'm being sarcastic, has come out of the woodworks and solved all the problems with solid-state batteries, including how to easily and quickly manufacture them at scale for automotive purposes. All I can say is, wow, it is so incredible, it is almost unbelievable. And if we scroll down further in the article, we can see that according to the CEO, all that needs to be done is simply build a manufacturing plant and then scale up production. Which, if we look here, is where we get led to the sales pitch. The CEO makes it sound like they are so close and that all they need to do is manufacture the battery cells, which they cannot do without raising capital, which requires money from you. So let me break this down for you real quick, and then we will jump back over to the Scorpion report. QuantumScape has operated in stealth mode for over 10 years. Suddenly come out of the woodwork with a magic material that solves all the previous problems with solid-state batteries and is ready to mass produce them in a way that is economically viable and scalable. But they can't do so without the generous support of retail investors like you. So really guys, at the end of the day, this reeks of a snake oil salesman pitch that relies on the super secret magic separator material to make all of it happen. And if this super secret magic material doesn't work out, then QuantumScape has nothing, and the stock is worthless. So with that being said, let's jump back over to the short seller report and focus on the arguments they make against this magic separator material. One of the biggest arguments the Scorpion Report makes against QuantumScape's magic separator material is that it needs to be incredibly thin to actually work. That is, as a viable competitor to current lithium-ion batteries. And this is because a thicker separator takes up more space in the battery, which lowers the energy density of the battery. And this is a big problem for QuantumScape, since there have been huge gains in the energy density of current lithium-ion batteries, especially since Tesla has gotten into the game. And the gains are so significant that over the next 5 years, QuantumScape's impressive energy density might not actually be that far ahead. So the solution is obviously to simply make the separator thinner. Right? Well, the problem of a thinner separator is that it makes the battery more susceptible to failure from dendrites. Also, a thin separator is more likely to fail in general just from normal stress of cycling the battery. And to explain this better, here's a quote from a former employee that I think sums up the problem quite nicely. Here's something so thin, and then you have to quickly charge and discharge electricity, and you can very easily get a dendrite forming, which is a spike growing on the anode side, and that spike is going to end up putting a hole into that thin separator because it's just too thin. If it's too thin, the dendrite is going to break a hole into it. But if you make it thicker, you're losing a lot of energy density because you're consuming more space. Not only that, but as these things expand and contract during all the cycling, it'll expand to a certain point where it shatters. So these are not easy problems to solve, and they represent fundamental trade-offs that will be very hard to overcome. Now, in terms of thickness, the separator material can be anywhere from 5 microns thick all the way up to 100 to 200 microns thick. But even though that is a big range, in order to get energy densities that are competitive, the thickness actually needs to be under 10 microns. In fact, according to a solid-state battery expert Scorpion interviewed, in order to get to the 400 watt-hours per kilogram that QuantumScape said was possible with their batteries, the separator thickness has to be well under 10 microns. Which, to put that in perspective for you, that is 10 times smaller than the thickness of a human hair, which can be anywhere from 50 to 100 microns thick. And what makes matters worse is that the energy density of the battery declines very quickly as the separator gets thicker. In fact, if the separator is between 20 to 30 microns thick instead of the 5 to 10 microns necessary, then the battery density will be cut in half to only 200 watt hours per kilogram, which is well below the energy density of Tesla's current car batteries. And speaking of Tesla, one of the hardest parts of making a commercially viable battery is the manufacturing process. Tesla has spent over a decade working to make lithium-ion batteries cost-effective for electric vehicles, and they are just now getting to the point where their cars are cheap enough and have high enough ranges to be affordable. And really, a lot of people would argue that Tesla's cars are still way too expensive. But according to Elon Musk, someone who has, by the way, quite a bit of battery manufacturing experience, he said recently in an interview that 99.9% of the challenge in battery cells comes during the manufacturing process. And when it comes to manufacturing, trying to manufacture large sheets of super thin ceramic separators will be very challenging for QuantumScape. Ceramic is a material that requires a process called sintering, which is basically cooking the material at very high temperatures, which will harden the ceramic into a durable material. But the sintering process can also create pinholes in the separator if there are any defects or debris on the material when it is going through the sintering process. And I want to share a quote from a former employee that I think sums up the difficulties of the sintering process quite well. The former employee says, trying to get the chemistry right to put into a furnace at that high of a temperature and have it perfectly come together in order to make something that's super uniform, super flat. Imagine if that sample isn't 100% flat and you put it into a battery. If it's not flat, it's not going to interact with the cathode and anode in different places, and the pressure points are where you can definitely see a crack or a pinhole forming. Those pinholes will instantly short the battery. So from this quote, we can see that being able to manufacture this super thin, highly sensitive separator material is going to be a big manufacturing challenge for QuantumScape, and it will require processes and environments that are not required for manufacturing current lithium-ion batteries, which will definitely add to the cost of QuantumScape's batteries. But cost aside, another big problem of QuantumScape's batteries is scale. Currently, QuantumScape's battery samples are incredibly small. In fact, the Scorpion report shows us just how small they are by comparing the QuantumScape lab sample to common items such as an iPhone and a hearing aid, just to put it in perspective. Compared to the iPhone 12 Max Pro, the QuantumScape battery has just 1/20th the capacity. And compared to a Duracell hearing aid battery, QuantumScape's battery has less than 1/3 of the capacity, which just goes to show you how little capacity it actually has. But this in and of itself is not a big problem. The problem instead comes when we start discussing scale. In order to build a battery capable of powering a car, QuantumScape will need to build a battery that is not just a single layer, but 50 to 100 layers stacked on top of each other. And given the fact that a Tesla Model 3 has 3,700 cells in it, each with 50 to 100 layers per cell, that means that QuantumScape will need to manufacture hundreds of thousands of layers just to power a single car. So the problems with defects in uniformity when manufacturing the separator are going to get compounded when you factor in the size of the separator sheets that they will need to make, and also the speed at which they will need to make them. So in my opinion, this is the single biggest problem facing QuantumScape as they work to take their small, single-layer laboratory battery and turn it into a viable commercial battery capable of being used in an EV. And honestly, guys, the fact that they haven't revealed the thickness of their separator they used in their test batteries is a giant red flag. Like we mentioned earlier, if the separator is too thick, then it will never be cost competitive with current lithium-ion batteries. And if it is too thin, then dendrites and stress will lead to a very unreliable and possibly even dangerous battery, capable of starting a fire at any second. So that's why, to me, I think this is the biggest problem, and it will be very difficult for QuantumScape to overcome at every step in the process. Now, there are a ton more slides that discuss the technology, but I want to keep this video somewhat short. So let's move on to the role that Volkswagen and other big backers have played in legitimizing QuantumScape. One of the biggest arguments against my video has been, but how could QuantumScape be a fraud? They are backed by Volkswagen. And my response to you is a simple one. Big companies and corporations don't always do their due diligence, like they should. In fact, the Scorpion Report points out many different examples of large corporations and billionaire investors who have lost large amounts of money to scams in the past. These include many large hedge funds piling into Luckin Coffee before its fraudulent activity was discovered, Walgreens and Safeway signing big partnerships deals with Theranos right before they were exposed, and the most recent one being GM signing a big deal with Nikola right before the Hindenburg report came out. And that Hindenburg report launched an SEC investigation into the company and sent the CEO into hiding. So to make that argument that QuantumScape can't be a fraud simply because Volkswagen is investing in them is absurd. For one, Volkswagen does not have a great track record when it comes to being open and transparent. In fact, Volkswagen lied to regulators for years about the emissions of their vehicles and were perfectly fine continuing to do so until they got caught in 2015. The scandal was called Dieselgate, and it has cost Volkswagen a ton of money, not only in terms of fines, but also in terms of brand reputation. And this came at a time when EVs were just starting to gain popularity, which made the optics of the Dieselgate scandal that much worse. Therefore, Volkswagen had no choice but to start investing heavily into EVs and battery technology to try and change people's perception about their brand. And the Scorpion Report hints at this reality on slide 12, where they say, "The VW leadership is desperate for media wins in the aftermath of Dieselgate and want to show investors they have an EV plan." So throwing $200 million in an innovative new battery startup and getting hundreds of articles written about your company for free is likely one of the key reasons that Volkswagen made the investment in the first place. And I know to you and I, $200 million might sound like a lot of money, especially to be investing into a speculative battery company. But keep in mind that Volkswagen spent an average of $6 billion a year on advertising from 2015 to 2018. So $200 million in exchange for hundreds of free articles being published on the internet talking about how good your brand is a pretty good bang for your buck. But the crazy part about all of this is that even though Volkswagen got a bunch of free press, they might also end up actually making money on their investment when everything is over. According to SEC documents, Volkswagen's $200 million investment was made in exchange exchange for 30 million shares of QuantumScape stock, and that was at an average price of $6.57 per share. This means that even after QuantumScape has fallen by 50% over the past week, Volkswagen is still up considerably on their investment. And with the lockup expiring soon, Volkswagen will most likely walk away with their original $200 million investment and a nice profit to show for it. So this is why when current VW employees said in the report that Volkswagen's partnership was just a passive equity investment, I was not really surprised at all. And despite QuantumScape CEO saying things like, Volkswagen has gone all in, or Volkswagen is committed to our technology, Volkswagen's actions seem to paint a different picture. In fact, Volkswagen recently announced a partnership with another battery manufacturer and placed a $14 billion order with them. Oh, and by the way, the contract is for the next 10 years. So if Volkswagen was serious about helping QuantumScape, then they would be investing way more than $200 million at this point. And likewise, if Volkswagen was confident that QuantumScape will have a commercially viable battery soon, they would have probably already started signing contract agreements to make sure they can secure enough batteries when that point comes. But with all that being said, the point is that the Volkswagen investment shouldn't mean much to you, and I think the report does a good job of laying out the reasons for why that's the case. Now, before I wrap up this video, let's look at a few key slides that I think raise some serious questions for QuantumScape investors. The first slide is slide number 25, and it highlights some inconsistencies with one of QuantumScape's charts from their December 8th Battery Day presentation. Scorpion Capital asked a leading solid-state battery expert to review the chart and were shocked by what they found. According to the solid-state expert, the blue line was not real data and showed no variation at all between data points. And this was contrasted with the gray line, which he said was actually real data. Now, after being tipped off about this anomaly, Scorpion Capital decided to enlarge both the blue line and the gray line, and this is the result. You can see that while the gray line shows uneven data points that appear to be randomly spaced, the blue line does not show any noticeable variation between the data points. Also, the blue line seems to just perfectly pass right inside of the dot, which represents an 80% charge in just 15 minutes, which is exactly what QuantumScape was trying to show with this chart. So to me, the perfectly spaced data points is a clear sign that QuantumScape is not being honest with their data, and it is one of the key slides in the entire Scorpion report that I think shows there might be some actual fraud going on. Now, one of the other slides that caught my attention was slide number 61, and in this slide, they show another chart from QuantumScape's Battery Day presentation. Now, in this chart, a leading solid-state battery expert noted that the broken line seems to show that QuantumScape used what is known as pulsing to falsely claim that their batteries were resistant to dendrites. Basically, what is happening here is that instead of applying a continuous current, QuantumScape pulsed the current so that dendrites were much less likely to form. However, in the real world, this is not how batteries are operated. Batteries in the real world are subjected to continuous use for long periods of time, especially when driving a car. So even though the test results in this slide are technically correct, this test proves nothing about the battery's ability to resist dendrites in real-world applications. Now, one last slide I want to talk about is slide number 170. And this slide stood out to me because it told a recent story of one of the biggest backers of QuantumScape, whose name is Vinod Khosla. According to QuantumScape's S-1 filing, Khosla is the second largest shareholder of QuantumScape stock behind Volkswagen, with 35 million shares, or 9.76% of the company. Now, what's interesting about Khosla is that he has a history of not only investing in fraudulent companies, but helping to pump up these same companies he's invested in. In slide 170, we see the history of a publicly traded company Khosla backed in the past called Kyor. Now, Kyor at the time was claiming, just like QuantumScape, to have a magic catalyst that could turn wood into oil in a matter of mere seconds, which on its face sounds almost too good to be true. In fact, it sounded so amazing that 60 Minutes actually ran a story on the company and interviewed Khosla about the claims. And when they asked Khosla if the claims were true and whether there were any downsides to the technology, Khosla replied, "There are no downsides." However, after making that statement, a short time later, Kyor was exposed as a fraud, and the Attorney General of Mississippi actually sued Khosla for fraud, accusing him of having knowledge of the fraud while continuing to take funding from the state government. And what is interesting is that Bill Gates also invested in Kyor at the same time with a $7.5 million initial investment, which is noteworthy because Bill Gates is also an investor in QuantumScape. Although what's interesting about Bill Gates' involvement is that it seems like he invested in Kior simply because he is friends with Khosla, which could also explain why he is an investor in QuantumScape as well. But that's kind of a minor point, and I don't want to focus on that too much. The bottom line is this. Although the Scorpion report does not have a smoking gun, the report still raises a lot of red flags and makes some very compelling arguments for why retail investors should be skeptical of QuantumScape's grand claims. And to me, the potential faking of data from their December 8th Battery Day presentation stands out to me as the most serious claims in the report. But even though the report does not definitively prove anything, that doesn't really matter. This is because, from an investment standpoint, there are really two things you must avoid if you want to be a successful investor. The first is don't lose money. And the second is don't invest in things that have a high chance of underperforming the market or going bankrupt. Now, when it comes to QuantumScape, I personally think QuantumScape fails both of these criteria. For one, stocks go up not based on hopes or goodwill thinking, but rather on cold hard results and execution. Also, stocks represent businesses, which might seem like a common sense statement, but let's go ahead and look up the definition of a business just so we are all clear. A business is the organized efforts and activities of individuals to produce and sell goods and services for a profit. Now, from this definition, we can see that the most important thing a business needs in order to be legitimate is a product or a service. Now, I recently got a comment on my last video where a commenter called me a bozo and argued that QuantumScape does in fact have a product. Well, let's look up the definition of product to see if this commenter is correct. The definition of a product is an object or substance that is manufactured or refined for sale. Based on this definition, QuantumScape can't possibly have a product because they don't even have a manufacturing facility yet, nor do they have something that is even capable of being manufactured at this point. So based purely on definitions, QuantumScape is not a business, and they don't have a product. They are instead better categorized as a research/development entity that is working on a prototype, which is completely different than investing in a business with sales of actual products. So maybe one day QuantumScape becomes successful, maybe they eventually develop a product, maybe they build a manufacturing facility, maybe they even achieve $10 billion in sales by 2028. Or maybe they do none of these things. The future is full of possibilities. But at the end of the day, as investors who are trying to make money in the stock market, we do not have the luxury of trust. Good investors look for businesses that have excellent products and a track record of good execution. And if a company has those two things and they operate in a market segment that has huge growth potential, then that company would be considered a good investment. But for QuantumScape, they have neither a history of execution or a viable product. So at the end of the day, we have no way of reasonably predicting or forecasting any level of success for QuantumScape stock, which makes QuantumScape an incredibly risky investment with a very low likelihood of success. So if you want to gamble and hope for a big payday one day, far off into the future, then go for it. Because in all reality, you only live once. And I think that's the best advice I can give you at this point. Now, if you stayed around all the way to the end of the video, I have a special piece of additional information that basically no one is talking about when it comes to QuantumScape stock, and that is when the lockup period expires. According to the S-1 form QuantumScape filed on December 31st, the lockup will expire on May 14th. However, the only condition that must be met is that the share price must trade above $12 a share for the 20 days before May 14th. If the price, however, drops below $12 a share before May 14th, then the lockup will extend to May 24th. So May 14th is a big day to mark on your calendar, since we could see a big sell-off in QuantumScape stock on or after that day. So keep that in mind and maybe wait to invest in QuantumScape stock until after that May 14th to May 24th deadline. At least that would be my advice. So if you enjoyed the video, make sure to hit that like button. Also, if you are new here, please consider hitting that subscribe button and hitting the bell notification so you are notified whenever I upload a new video. And with that being said, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.